All right, then we will call the meeting to order like last, uh-oh, something, my screen just disappeared. I need to get this resolution back up so I can read it. Okay.
I'll pull it up.
Like last time, I have to read resolution, which is, I'd like the commission to entertain a motion to approve resolution 2020-81, a resolution declaring that the Sustainability Commission shall meet on June 5th, 2020 and conduct its essential business by electronic means rather than being required to gather a quorum of the members physically present in the same location because it's necessary to protect the health, safety, and wellness, sorry, health, safety, and welfare of Tennesseans in light of the COVID-19 outbreak. Somebody make a motion, and do we have a second?
Move. Motion.
Second.
All right. And we'll go one by one here. I, nay, or recuse yourself. Patrick.
Aye.
Alderman Berger.
Aye.
Mike Cassidy.
Aye.
Mike Leonard and Brenton Montgomery are absent. Todd Palmer.
Aye.
Nancy is absent. Micah Wood.
Aye.
And then myself, Dana Kos, aye. All right. And then the next thing I need to read again is the announcement for limited public access due to the COVID-19 outbreak. This meeting will be a virtual meeting. The public may call 615-550-8420 to listen to the meeting and make comments during any public comment period. The public may also email comments to planningintake@franklintn.gov to be read aloud during the meeting. Emails comments were accepted until yesterday at 5 p.m. The meeting video will be available for public viewing following the meeting on the City of Franklin Facebook and YouTube accounts and the City of Franklin website. All right, so welcome to June, everyone. The first item on our agenda is to approve the May meeting minutes. Is there a motion and a second to approve these minutes?
Move for approval.
Second.
Great, thank you. And then again, we'll go one by one, starting with Patrick for I, nay, or recuse yourself.
Aye.
Alderman Berger.
Aye.
Mike Cassidy.
Aye.
And we'll skip to Todd Palmer.
Aye.
And Micah?
Aye.
And myself, Dana? Aye. All right. That gets us through the sort of the administrative items. The next item on the agenda is the consideration of the energy policy guide, which we've discussed and emailed around comments and feedback. Since the meeting last May, we incorporated feedback not only from the May meeting, we also gathered feedback by email from commission members and as well from commission or from city staff. And we've incorporated those comments and feedback into the document. Most of the comments were minor, I don't think there were any major changes. What I'd like to present as a next step is that we present this document to BOMA for feedback, not necessarily approval, but feedback, and then amend the document based on BOMA feedback, then bring it back to the commission to approve as a Sustainability Commission document and start as a commission delving into the policy statement and taking action on the items. Is there any discussion on that approach in terms of presenting to BOMA, getting feedback, and then approving the document as a Sustainability Commission document? All right. So then,
good,
I guess,
good procedure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I was going to say, I guess I'll take silence as acceptance there. So Andrew and I worked together to get on the an agenda for BOMA and present this document to them and let you know how that goes. Thank you. Look at that, Andrew. We're caught up. Next item is a discussion of streetlight costs.
And we do have Kevin Ogles on the line, and he sent me over this spreadsheet. And I thought, you know, it'd probably be best to have Kevin on the line to help kind of give a brief overview of it and then take any questions. I know there's a lot of information in there, but we essentially asked him to look at three different areas of town. We asked him to look at the lights on Mallory between Liberty and McEwen, so across from Centennial High School. We asked him to look at the lights in Founders Point, which is a large subdivision on the west side of town. And then also the lights in Cool Springs East, which is a residential subdivision on the east side of town. So what he's showing is kind of a breakdown of costs. If we were to pay for the lights outright and have them install them, or if we were to just pay the stranded cost of the light and have Middle Tennessee Electric take care of the upfront cost. And then I believe the current fee and what we're paying is in there as well. So I'll turn it over to Kevin.
Yeah, so we did those three projects. I think a couple of them, depending on how much the light costs, sometimes you come out better changing them to LED, sometimes you may not. I also did the one for the Sycamore Drive area. And one thing I think that you can take from this is if you look at the Sycamore Drive costs, is when all of the utility pole mounted Cobra heads, they're at 11%. So you're going to get the most benefit out of changing those because you're already paying a pretty high facility charge on those. So you'll get the energy reduction plus reduction in the facility charge, changing those out. Some of the post top lights or the decorative lights are much more expensive. So changing to LED does not, it doesn't help you as much because it's a really high cost to change those lights out. And it may be better to let us change them out as they go bad. But you can always, you know, pay up front and we'll do whichever option you want. If there's any specific questions, Andrew, does everyone have a copy of this or is this, I think the...
Yes.
Okay. So you can see kind of a summary of each area there at the bottom. Can you scroll down to the bottom of this spreadsheet? Is there anything beneath that? Go to the, I thought I'd put a summary of the cost at the bottom. I may have done that later. But this is, that right there is kind of an explanation. I wish I'd had the other spreadsheet here. See if Founders Point has, if any of them have a summary there. They don't. Is there any way I can share my screen on here?
Yeah, Andrew? I can turn it over to you.
Let's see, do I need to click something?
I think I do.
I got a share screen button here, Fettle.
Whoops, are you? Screen share.
Andrew, I think you'll just need to stop your screen share and then he can start his.
It says host disabled participant screen sharing.
Hey, Kevin, yeah, why don't Andrew, you just send that over to Andrew right quick and then he can pull it up from his email.
Andrew, if you go down to the screen share, there should be a little arrow beside it where you can allow someone else to screen share.
Okay, you should be good now. Thank you.
Can Are you seeing a bunch of screens or just can you see this? Let's see. So, yeah.
Are you pulling up spreadsheet? Are you pulling up the Excel?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Yeah.
I have a more current version with the Sycamore Drive on it. It's all the costs, all of them. I can shoot you this in an email, Andrew, real quick, and you can.
Send it over to us because I've got mine pulled up on.
Yeah, that's fine.
Here on my computer.
Okay, one second.
The picture, but that's fine.
I wonder if I send this with the, let's see if I can. I'll send it to Andrew and let him.
So I'm looking at it. Can I ask some questions while we're?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm looking, just make sure I'm getting this right. Well, I'll wait till it's pulled up. So we're all on the same page, I guess.
I sent you that in an email, Andrew.
Great. I got it. I'm just going to forward it on to everybody on the call. All right. And I'll open it up. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen again.
Okay, yeah. So that's the new, that's the, you know, you wanted for the Sycamore Drive area, there's a, that's the cost estimate for that area. If you go to the bottom, it kind of gives you a summary there. Of
oh, great.
Your 9% investment or your pay as you go and what your current cost is. So you're going to save a couple hundred dollars a month with only $3,000 upfront cost. So I think that one would work out pretty good. And the reason for that is the cover heads are a lot cheaper. They're a lot closer to the price of a HID light. HID light might cost $100 and LED costs $200. So when you go from one to the other, especially with the 9% investment charge, you're really getting close to the same cost, and then you save a lot on energy too. So with your decorative lights, some of those lights cost usually $1,500. So when you change the LED head out, the value of the light does not go up that much. So the 11% and the 9% doesn't, you're not necessarily saving money by going to 9% on facilities. You're saving some on energy still, but it doesn't, the LED portion is a smaller portion of the overall cost of the light. So.
Okay. And Sycamore Drive is in the neighborhood where we converted the Ash Drive lights to LEDs, so it's north of Liberty Pike. between Mac Hatcher and the factory. Do you know approximately how many lights that is?
Yeah, if you go up to the top there, it'll tell you, I think it's 30-something.
30? Okay.
36, maybe. That top.
Yep, 30.
Yeah, 36.
Okay.
So if you do it the 9% investment option, charge option, the city would pay $3,100 up front. That's that stranded cost.
Yeah. Right?
And then the monthly cost is $281. And right now, paying about $499, $500 a month.
And those costs aren't exact, but they're somewhere in that area. So
how long does the 9% go? How long is that indefinitely?
Yeah, it goes on indefinitely.
That was my question. I was going to ask the same thing.
And does the current cost of about $500, does that go on indefinitely too?
Yeah, it goes on indefinitely too. So you're not just financing the light, you're also financing the maintenance on that light. So if it goes bad in 2 years, we're going to change it, and you're still going to pay the same price. It's not going to affect your monthly bill if we change the light up. So.
It's a 15 month payback period.
That's an annual charge. It's a 15 year. That's that investment charge. It's actually 9% divided by 12. So if you're looking at it monthly, that's a 9% annual investment charge. So you're paying 9% of the what that light's worth every year. So it should probably come out to more like 11 or 12 years for a full payback. And if you figure in present value of money, I don't know how to do all that. It'll probably stretch it out even longer than that. So,
I want to know bottom line. There's a lot of talk going on here and a lot of numbers thrown out, but bottom line, can you explain what's the best savings where here?
I think you're spending $3,000 and saving $200 a month. So,
on which one are you talking about, Sycamore?
Yeah, on Sycamore. So, and maybe that's what you were talking about. The payback on this is you're saving $200 a month, so you should get that $3,000 back in 16 months. So, and be paying a lower rate after that. So. And that's because these are utility pole mounted lights, which we installed on the front end. So they're all, you're already paying an 11% facility charge on those. Does that make sense to everyone as far as the 9% investment charge and the current cost? Those are the two that you should look at. I think you could prove that in pretty easily. So.
Obviously, I'm not looking at the same thing you're looking at. Okay.
Yeah, this one makes sense. Can we look at the summaries of the other three?
Yeah, go ahead.
Where does it say what we're looking at? I don't see where it says Sycamore.
It's in that tab down there. I just made a new worksheet for every area.
Yeah, I saw it, but I don't see where it differentiates for. I'm looking for the word Sycamore. I don't see that anywhere. So I'm trying to figure. I'm looking at all these things, but I don't know what's what.
See where Andrew's circling his mouse there.
Hold on. Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. You're talking about the tabs. Yes. Yes. Yeah. I'm sorry. And scroll down. So I was on the right sheet. Okay. I've got it. Yeah. So those are all Sycamore, every one of those?
No, that's Sycamore. And then each tab is a different one. So you got Cool Springs East, Founders.
Right. But if I'm on Sycamore, how many total lights are we talking about here?
There's 36 in the Sycamore area. And you can see they're all different sizes, and most of them are Cobra heads. There's a few post lights in there.
Okay. I see it. Okay. I got it.
And part of the reason the Sycamore Drive one makes financial sense is that there are a lot of mercury vapor lights, which Middle Tennessee Electric doesn't. I don't believe you charge the strain for those, correct?
Yeah, we haven't been charging strain and cost on the mercury vapor. You can't. I don't think you can buy parts for them anymore. I think you still buy bulbs, but they're pretty old, so.
So those would actually be due for needed upgrades anyway, kind of be a amenity
for the. Well, I mean, we're gonna, as long as they'll still light a bulb up, we'll leave them up in the air. So
right, I'm just from the city side. I think it would be helpful to upgrade the, you know, the lights for that neighborhood at least.
Mm-hmm. Is the current policy that once one of these lights is damaged or components that require I think you said before it has three parts. Bulb is just one of the three.
Yeah, normally you got a bulb. You've actually got four parts to a light that can be changed on the HID light. You can change the bulb, change the photocell, change the starter, and you can change the ballast.
Okay.
The ballast is probably the most expensive part, and if a ballast goes bad, we're probably going to just throw the light in the trash. So.
So is the current policy on Sycamore or these other places that have those lights, if one of those goes bad and you can't get the parts, that is the policy to automatically upgrade it to an LED under the current?
Yeah, we're definitely not going back with any HID lights. So if we change the light out, we go to LED, and I'm pretty sure we're not ordering ballasts anymore. I don't know 100%, but I think we've gotten away from ordering ballasts. We will change the bulb or photocell because those are pretty cheap compared to the total cost of the light.
And of the census of lights throughout the city, these four tabs would make up what percent of the street lights out there?
I didn't catch you were cutting out there.
Just saying, if you put those four tabs and that you've analyzed and sum that up, what's the percent of the total inventory of street lights would these represent on these four tabs?
Those four tabs are I think we've got a little over 20 something thousand lights total on our system, and you're looking at all of these together is less than 100. So this isn't much. This isn't much at all. Now I say that 27,000 goes across all four counties. So you guys probably have a third of that. So you're looking at 6,000 to 7,000 lights probably. Okay. And this is a couple hundred at most.
How many other Sycamore Drive type scenarios are there in the city? How many mercury?
Yeah, there's I think we had 300 and something mercury vapors. We can't just go change out all the mercury vapors. That'd be a separate project. We'll change them out if we're changing lights out in the area if they go bad. So, but yeah, there's 300 and something in the city of Franklin. I sent Andrew a map showing where they're all at. So did you get that, Andrew?
Is that what you said, 300 and some mercury vapors left in the city?
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
Andrew's got a map of where they're at, so you can kind of see they're spread out all over the place.
Not necessarily all. I mean, they're not necessarily. Is this like one of the more highly concentrated areas of?
You'll find them in the older parts of town. There's a lot of them around the residential areas around downtown and stuff like that, where you'll have a mercury vapor, then a high pressure sodium mixed in. So,
you know, even I know it's probably not realistic for you to, like you just said, you can't just target them specifically, but maybe over time. Over a couple years, we would target those or to target the ones with the financial impact that we see here like on Sycamore, knowing that there's probably some constraints on how quickly and how, you know, Yeah. I can go do ones and twosies, you know, but, you know, I don't know, that might be, because that makes financial sense. These others, not so much, I don't think. I mean, they do over time, but not.
Yeah.
The stranded costs are just too high because I guess they're so new. So.
Yeah, if you're paying 0% on a decorative light right now, you're probably not going to see the savings that would warrant changing that light out to LED at your cost anyway. You should probably wait until we change it out.
So Andrew, what's the process for just making a decision? Like for Sycamore, of these four areas, Sycamore seems like the most, makes the most financial sense. What's the process for choosing an area and getting approval to do one of these or more?
Well, I think we can work with Middle Tennessee Electric to try and identify some areas where it does make sense. Also pick it up with background noise. So if anybody's not speaking, make sure they're muted. And then we work kind of internally through a committee called the CIP committee or CIC committee. And we can kind of discuss these projects internally and make sure we can get funding in place, or if it is a low cost, like, you know, $3,000 is probably within the realm of being able to work it into a current budget, then that might be achievable. But if it, you know, if it's going to be a bigger cost, then that's something we'd have to kind of work into a next year's budget.
So my question is along with Dana's. So after this meeting today, what's the next step to move towards this? Because I think we should move towards doing some stuff over here on doing some of these lights on Sycamore. I mean, it makes sense. Mm-hmm. So where do we take that, Andrew?
Well, we did the ash drive. There's an internal CIP meeting made up of the city administrators,
right,
engineering directors of different departments, and we presented the ash drive project to them, and there was broad support, and we were able to work it into the streets department budget to pay for the stranded cost of those lights on ash drive. So we'd probably do something similar.
Okay, that's great.
And that project moved quickly. You know, we identified that one, got it into the CIP staff meeting, got broad support for it. Middle Tennessee Electric sent us an invoice. We processed it pretty quickly, and then they worked fast on their end. So it all came together within probably, you know, 2 months from origination. And that one actually originated through a Facebook post from a resident on Ash Drive who was asking for improved lighting.
Alderman Berger, if I could just say one thing additionally, we do occasionally get approached by some development subdivisions, HOAs, that request some LED. And
okay,
what we have told them recently was if they're willing to pay for the upfront cost of the up equipping, if you would, the lights, changing them out to LED, then we will continue to pick up the stranded cost.
Is that how we ended up getting the Cool Springs on this list?
I'm not sure about Cool Springs. I've they've not personally reached out to me. I'm not sure if they have Andrew or not.
No,
yeah, I know.
No, it's, Alderman, I just asked Kevin to look at a couple different areas of, and this was just one of the ones I tried to make it a diverse group of areas of town.
Yeah, I think East Cool Springs people have mentioned to me before that they have some dark areas over there that they were trying to see if they could get fixed. So I'm going to be listening here, and I have to get ready to get into the car to travel somewhere. But I'm here. So I'm just putting y'all on mute unless there's some other question, but I'll be here. Thank you.
Well, Dana, should we wrap up this discussion and move to walk friendly? And streetlights is something that's going to be something we kind of continue to chip away at. I think that's what we're realizing, that certain neighborhoods, maybe it's going to make sense to go ahead and do a retrofit, and there's going to be a quick payback. In other areas of town, we may end up paying an increased cost retrofitting, so maybe hold off on those for now. But this is something that we can continue to work with Middle Tennessee Electric on and chip away at.
That sounds like a good plan.
Thanks, Kevin.
So the next up is, yeah, thanks, Kevin. You're welcome to stay on for the rest of the discussion too, if you'd like. So next we're gonna talk about walk-friendly communities, and Eric, looks like Kevin has the screen ready for you. Are you ready, Eric?
Yeah, let me take control though so I can kind of flip through at my pace. Does everybody see that?
Eric, do I need to stop sharing mine?
I don't know. It says that I'm screen sharing, so I don't know what I actually am.
Here, I'll stop sharing. You can pull it up. There we go.
Okay. So, for the last 2 months or so, Andrew and I have been working on the Walk Friendly Community application. So we just kind of want to give you guys a heads up on what exactly is going on and what that actually means. The design is approaching.
Hey, is it just me or is Eric, you're kind of mumbled? I don't know. Is it just me?
No. It's a bad voice connection. Okay. So.
Sounds kind of cool, actually.
It's too early for that, Damon.
Is that better? Can you hear me? Can people hear me? Is this still?
No, that's better.
That's better.
Okay.
Much better. Thank you.
It's in the little box. I don't know if it's detecting it. But, so, yeah, we've been working on this. The deadline is approaching here on the 15th. So, we're nearing the end. And so, this is just going to give you an overview of what the designation actually is, what is going on in the application, just so everyone's a little bit privy to it. So, the walk friendly.
I think it's still happening. Can you call in?
Yeah.
That usually is my troubleshoot when I could just call in and see what happens. Let's see if that works.
Either that or your headset. It could be a poor connection from your headset to your computer. Those are my two go-tos.
Micah, I'm still waiting on my coffee.
Be waiting a while. To this point. You can come on down the street. I've got some right here.
Hey, I might.
I don't know. Next month, we may not have the ability to have virtual meetings anymore. The governor's order only goes through the end of June, and we're not sure if he's going to renew it.
Yeah. Yeah, several of the ones I'm dealing with are actually already in June going to in-person meetings, unfortunately.
Speaking of that, the July meeting, the first Friday in July is July 3rd, which is a city holiday. So I think we can either push the meeting back to maybe July 10th? Or, you know, historically we take July off, but we also took April off. So I just wanted to throw that out there for discussion. Yep, we got you, Eric.
You got me? Okay. I'm on speakerphone, so if there's feedback or anything, just let me know.
Sounds much better. Thank you.
Much better, yeah.
Yeah, it was working yesterday, so I don't know what happened, but that's fine. Let me pull this stuff back up. All right, and everyone can see that still?
I can see it.
Yep.
You can? Okay. So the Walk Friendly Community designation is just a national program that encourages towns and cities to establish and recommit to a higher priority for supporting safer walking environments. It's kind of their tagline. It's a nonprofit organization that does these designations, just recognizing the communities that are working to improve the conditions for walking, such as safety, mobility, access, and comfort. There are currently 76 cities across the nation that have received either a bronze, silver, gold, or platinum designation since the program began about 10 years ago. There's an additional 21 cities that have honorable mentions, and that includes us. We received that, I believe, in the first year of the program's history, because I think it was 2011 was when we received it. So. We've been an honorable mention for a long time, and I don't believe we've applied to get that bronze designation since we got the honorable mention. So this is kind of our second shot at it, and hopefully the changes and growth that we've had in the last 10 years will help get us there. So what's involved in the application? It's pretty comprehensive. There's everything from just a general community profile and evaluating the programs that we have, specific information about the planning policies and procedures that we have, engineering and design, looking at the engineering standards that we have in place and what we do when we're constructing new street improvements and whatnot. Education and encouragement, all the programs that we have from Safe Routes to School to just general walking advocacy and educating everyone on how to be safe, you know, when crossing and whatnot. And then enforcement actions, everything from like ticketing jaywalking to how many times we ticket people for parking over a sidewalk and whatnot. So, it's very broad and specific for everything that we do. So what's the point of us spending all this time going through this application and trying to get this designation? Well, it really just helps us get that third party feedback of the areas that we're doing well and what areas we can improve on. Because after we apply, we get a big long feedback sheet that goes over each of those specific areas that I mentioned and tells us the things that we're doing well and what we could improve on and sort of what levels each of those things are at. So if we do end up getting just an honorable mention again, we know specifically which areas are weak that we could improve on to help get us up to that next level. And if we're successful, it really just sets us apart from the communities around us. As you saw probably in the email, there are no walk-friendly communities in Tennessee that have this designation, and we're the only ones that even have an honorable mention. So it really would help just set us apart from everybody else, saying that, you know, this is how to do it correctly, and everyone can use us as a model to help make their communities more friendly or more walk friendly. And it really just helps give us recognition for the work that we've done here in the city, just ensuring pedestrian connectivity and requiring all those amenities with new development. And it really does help just provide that justification for the standards that we create here in planning as well as in engineering. For elevating those standards of development within the public right-of-way, those capital improvement projects and requiring it with private development. We can really point to that and say, you know, this is what we are, this is what we've achieved, and we're striving for more. So we are requiring these, and it helps kind of give us that footing to make that, you know, part of what we're doing here. So, and just really help justify it. So there is a June 15th deadline. So not this coming Monday, but the following Monday. And I'd say we're probably about 80% complete. There's a few little tidbits of information that I'm still trying to chase down, because it does rely on so many different people, and it's not something that just like Andrew and I can do. It requires us to go out and get this information. And because of that, you know, especially with no one being in the office and all this stuff that's going on, it makes it a little bit more difficult to track down the people that we need to. But so yeah, that's just kind of a brief overview on what exactly the walk-friendly community designation is and sort of what we're trying to accomplish with it. So I'm happy to answer any questions or, you know, give you guys some more information if you would like it.
I've got a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Is that Dana? Can I pop in on this?
Yep, go ahead.
Yeah, okay, great. I'm in the car now traveling south, so I'm like, I make sure I don't lose y'all signal or anything, so I thought maybe I'll try to get my question in. Can you tell me when this designation and everything, do they look at, or does it have anything to do with, or do they concentrate at all or focus at all on walk friendly to in relationship to crossing at intersections? Because one of my big things here in Cool Springs is the fact that we're talking about walk friendly, walkable communities, but we really don't do a really good job to get our pedestrians across the street at intersections. I think, and this may sound pretty harsh, but I think we don't do a very good job of that at all. And I don't think it's purposely that we don't do that. I just don't think we focus on that. And I've had more problems with trying to get pedestrians across streets. And just recently at the roundabout at McEwen, Cool Springs, Oxford Glen, at that roundabout, we put in pedestrian walk cross, you know, the lines on the road for them to get across, and they had it, and they weren't going to put signs up at all. And one of the biggest things that we have in our city is people abuse the state law to stop for pedestrians. So does this come into play at all in this designation or in addressing it?
Yes. Crosswalks are a part of the engineering standards that we have. And we need to put in information about what types of crosswalks we do. Typically, like the percentage of intersections that have them, what type of crossing lights we use, what type of button feedback systems we have, if they're ADA compliant, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, and things that enhance safety. Because first of all, we were striping the crosswalks at the roundabout, but we were not putting up signs. And when I found out we were not putting up signs, it's like, well, why not? First of all, I think we have an overabundance of signs. I think the city is the biggest abuser of signs. We put up way too many. So it's like, oh my gosh, do I ask for these signs or not? But in critical places, especially at crosswalks, because we have such a problem, and we really do have a problem here with people in vehicles that don't stop for pedestrians. And pedestrians are standing there waiting to cross, and yet the car after car after car will go by, and very rarely do you find a car that stops to allow the pedestrians to cross. So I'm very, very interested in focusing on that. And I'm just going to put this out there that I think our Sustainability Commission could focus on this for a future project as well. But I just wanted to make sure that this was part of it, and I don't know if we'll fall down in that area or not. I have no idea. Thanks.
Eric, is that something that going through this process would help us identify where there's an issue with crosswalks, or is it generally that the feedback we would get would say you have an issue with your pedestrian crossing?
Yeah, because the information that we put in on crosswalks, you know, it's not like a community-wide inventory of crosswalks. It's like approximately how many, you know, percentage-wise intersections have crosswalks, what type of crosswalk striping is it, you know, that kind of thing. You know, maybe they come back and say that your 75% isn't high enough. You know, at that point, then we go, okay, well, we take that feedback. We would need to go to engineering or streets and say, like, okay, let's start identifying where we don't have these stripes that we need to put in because we're seeing pedestrian issues, kind of thing. So it would be definitely like a very much a first step, but we're not going to get the kind of specific feedback that says, like, you need a crosswalk at the corner of, you know, X and Y.
Okay. Thank you. And I have one other question. Is it, you said within city limits, not just a certain area of Franklin, right?
Correct. So this is across the community. Okay. So there's okay. Obviously, you know, the data and information that we send is going to end up getting skewed because of like really high pedestrian counts downtown versus low pedestrian counts, you know, elsewhere. So because we have such a drastic range of where people walk and where people don't, it kind of makes it even harder for them to give that specific feedback. Luckily, we do have very safe numbers, but a lot of that is just because outside of downtown, there's not a whole lot of walking going on. So it's a good thing and a bad thing.
Bingo, you hit the nail on the head, and that's our big problem is outside downtown. Now, I will tell you, during the COVID thing, we did have people out walking. We all know that. We have met more neighbors. We've seen more people. It's like we have an entire community that just came alive, and they're out there walking all over the place, biking and walking and strolling. And it's amazing. And so, you know, I find it ironic that we are designated a pet city, but we should be being, you know, and that's fine. I think that's great, but why not be designated a pedestrian friendly city? And I'd like to know how we get there. And if this designation or information that we're doing here on this helps us to do that. And I'll put that out there for our sustainability commission people on this call to think about that. We need to talk about this in the future. Andrew, I'd love to have a section on our agenda sometime that we can talk about this, because it's going to be a huge education, just like blue bag, blue rollout, blue containers, total education program. And I think this is the same, because this is a state law about pedestrians. But anyway, I'll leave that go for now, but let's talk about that later. And I appreciate the information that was given today. It's very helpful.
Are we going to try to make the June 15th filing, or is it a December thing?
Yeah, so the goal is June 15th. Honestly, we're going to submit for June, even if maybe there's a little bit of information that we still haven't been able to gather or is not as complete as we'd like. We'll still submit in June. There is another submittal in December, so push comes to shove, if we don't receive bronze, then we'll still have basically an already completed application, and then we'll just have a handful of months to gather up anything that they say was weak or that we could need more information on, and then resubmit in December.
Eric, would the idea be to submit for bronze and then work toward climbing up the, you know, I'm assuming there's silver and gold as well, with feedback that they provide, or is it just to get in as kind of the recognition from this organization about the walk friendly nature of the community?
You know, I do think ideally we should strive to continue to get better. Now, because of the steps are pretty significant from just looking at the different cities. And, you know, like your platinums are the peak of walking. So, I mean, that's like New York City and, you know, like Portland and Boulder and all these cities that have this really, really robust public transit system that encourages people to walk. So I think maybe striving for silver in the next 5 to 10 years wouldn't be out of the question. But it's not something that we'll be able to just like turn around next year and get silver, just because of like minor changes. It would take some pretty heavy legwork to continue moving this forward and boost us up to that next step. Now, maybe we'll be surprised and we'll do better than we think, but I think there are some just facts that are going to kind of hurt us in this, mostly the very, very small number of people that like walk to work or bike to work. Pretty much everyone drives and, you know, not that many people even carpool. So I think that's going to hurt us, as well as just the fact that we don't exactly have a strong inventory of what we have. Right. So I think there are just a few little things that are going to kind of keep us down in that bronze area, but there's nothing that says that if we don't, you know, take this and hit the ground running with it, that we can't get silver, you know, before 2030.
Good. Well, I wholeheartedly support this. I think this is something that Franklin has not kept up with even cities that are smaller than us in terms of pedestrian connectivity. So I think this is a good thing. And as Alderman Berger was saying, if that's something we can then work towards as a commission, I think this would be a huge plus for the community. So.
Yeah, I'm hoping as a commission, we will really take this on because this is really an important issue for our community. And again, I think the last couple months we've seen how much people do come out, will come out, actually, when they had the time and the opportunity to come out. And we have a lot of people that live in the Cool Springs area that work in the Cool Springs area. And maybe we can devise a way to help get them. I'm sorry. I've got my GPS in the back. Maybe we can work towards helping to get them on their feet and on their bikes to get to work too. So I would love to see what else you know. I'd like to have a list. Get there. I like to look at all those particulars later on.
Yeah,
when we get the report back, the feedback report, at least in 2011, it was about a month and a half to 2 months afterwards. So we'll be sure to send that around to you all, as well as all of our, you know, elected officials and whatnot, to kind of spread that feedback around so that everyone can see what this third party is thinking about the work that we're doing. So
can I ask Andrew and Emily, I don't remember going through this in 2011. Was it something that engineering did or was it somebody?
No, I worked on that probably 2010, got it back probably in 2011.
Huh.
And I relied heavily on, you know, Rose from police.
Yeah.
Carl in engineering, GIS to be able to get some information. It was definitely a total team effort putting it all together.
Okay. So that flew out of my head somehow.
But we got honorable mention, so we weren't, you know, super pumped. And, you know, I doubt we
shared the participation ribbon, right?
But it is a very stringent rating system. So, I mean, even honorable mention, we didn't feel terrible about that. Because there are a lot of communities that received honorable mention, like Eric said, 21 others. So it's a pretty rigorous application, and they hold you to a high standard.
Well, thanks for the presentation, Eric. Good luck with the rest of the application. Look forward to seeing how it turns out and discussing this on a future agenda of what else we can do as a city to make it more walkable. I think the last thing, Andrew, you had started the conversation about our July meeting, and then Emily mentioned that we're not sure if we can hold it virtually or not. So I guess, how did you want to go about that, Andrew? Do you want to temporarily reschedule it to July and or to July 10th and see how that goes? Or do you want to get feedback from the group on whether or not we meet?
I think we should meet.
Okay.
We've had
everyone okay with
times off. We may be back in person by July too.
Okay. Well, I'll send out a meeting invitation for July 10th and we'll go from there.
Okay. Great.
One thing.
Any other news? Go ahead, Emily.
I'm going to say one thing you might want to consider if we are meeting in person for July, because we're not able to meet virtually anymore, we might want to schedule it for the training room instead. That'll give people a little bit more room to spread out.
Yeah, the training room.
Yeah. Yes, I'm glad you mentioned that. I had that thought earlier and I forgot to think. Yeah, that'd be great. So if we need to shift the date a little bit for when that training room might be available, if there are other commissions that also want to meet in their other groups, just let us know, Andrew. But hopefully we can snag that July 10th at 8 a.m.
And if not, we can all go to Biscuit Love. I'm sure we
all
can twist
favor.
Arms.
Yes.
Aye.
All right. Any other news before we adjourn then?
Yep.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Have a great weekend.
Thanks.
And hope to see you next month.
Thanks, Sean. Bye.